Jamie, the RRSP contribution deadline just around the corner, the end of February, and that tax deadline for I guess most people is April 30th. Let's talk about tax strategies. Maybe let's start off with RRSP contributions. What will move the needle, or how do you figure out what's going to move the needle on your return when it comes to RRSP contributions?
Well, I think the most important thing you need to be on top of is your own personal RRSP contribution limit. Now, that's going to be different for every person, unless you're someone who is completely maxed out every single year. The easiest way to find out what that is take a look at your copy of your notice of assessment that you would have gotten for your 2022 tax return. On there, you'll see actually a full accounting of your RRSP contribution available. And if you don't have that, you can actually go online to the CRA's My Account. You log into the My Account, you can actually see your contribution amount and your limit for 2023. The deadline, the end of February, is important because that is the deadline to be able to claim a deduction on your 2023 tax return. If you miss that deadline, you can still contribute the day after, but you won't be able to claim that deduction until your 2024 tax return. So I think people should know their contribution limit. I'm a big fan of RRSPs. I think most people should be maximizing their RRSPs. The only exception to that would be people that maybe still have tax-free savings account opportunities and that are maybe in lower tax brackets. But RRSPs still the greatest way to save for retirement.
Just before we get into that and hoping that you'll make the case further on the on that one, should you be taking out a loan then to maximize your RRSP contribution? I mean, we're looking at these higher borrowing rates now.
I would say in very limited and rare situations, would you want to take out an RRSP loan? And the reason for that, of course, is that if you can't afford to pay it back, these loans become very expensive. The interest rate is, you know, relatively high these days. And also the interest is not tax deductible when you borrow to put money into your RRSP. On the other hand, there are some situations where an RRSP loan can make a lot of sense. If you have an opportunity now to make that deadline, take that loan, make the contribution, then repay most or not all of that loan as soon as you get your tax refund, that works out really, really well. The problem is if you can't afford to pay it back and this drags on for months, it becomes a very, very expensive way to make an RRSP contribution. And it fairly, I think in very limited situations would that actually make sense. So, you know, if you're getting a bonus, you're getting in cash, you're getting a big refund, or you have a plan to pay off the RRSP loan in the next few months, I would say at the maximum, then yes, go for it. Otherwise, maybe it's better just waiting till you have the cash to make that RRSP contribution.
Let's talk about your thesis then, why RRSP investing makes sense, even though I guess you're gonna be paying tax on that money when you withdraw it.
Yeah, well, what people fail to understand is that the RRSP allows you to effectively earn tax-free income on the net contribution. What I might mean by that is if you earn $10,000 of income and you're in a 30% tax bracket, if you don't put that $10,000, let's say, into an RRSP, then you're going to lose 30% of it right off the top. And your net investment for non-registered investing is only $7,000. If you're in $10,000 of income, you put it into your RRSP, the full $10,000 goes into your RRSP. And when you run the math on this over periods of time, you'll always find that, of course, assuming that the rates, the tax rate today is the same as the tax rate in the future, you'll always find the RRSP will do better than the non-registered. There's simply more money there. And with the same rates of return, you're going to have more money at the end of the day. When some people get a little bit confused is they say, well, my tax rate right now is relatively low or middle. And ultimately, when I take the money out, I might be in a higher tax bracket. In that case, there is some legitimacy to the argument about not doing RRSPs, but only if you don't have a long enough time horizon. We've shown mathematically that if that money's in there for 20, 30 years or more, and you get a decent rate of return, even the effect of a higher tax rate on withdrawal or retirement or even on death will actually outweigh the fact that you actually have had all these years of tax-free compounding. So in other words, I think for most people, RRSPs beat non-registered investing. For some people, maybe TFSAs are better than RRSPs until you fully maxed out your TFSA room.
Let's just get into some other tax strategies as we gear up towards that end of April deadline. What else should we be thinking about as we get ready to file taxes?
Well, I think the biggest thing that's new, in fact, one of the only things that's new for 2023 is for employees that have been working from home during 2023. There's a very significant change in the tax rules from the last 3 years. You might recall that in 2020, 2021, and 2022, the Canada Revenue Agency allowed individual employees to claim $2 a day for every day they worked at home for up to $500 last year or in 2022. That's no longer available. In other words, the simplified method of calculating your work from home expenses has been eliminated for 2023. And that means that individual employees who have been working from home, as long as you've been working from home more than half the time during 4 weeks in the year, now can use what's called the detailed method. And effectively, you've got to actually detail all your actual expenses, utilities, rent, now any other expenses for the use of your home office, prorate that by the space that you're using, and then claim that actual deduction on your return. You also are going to need a copy of a form T2200 from your employer, something that was not required during the last few years if you use the simplified method. So I think the bottom line is that for employees that have been working from home during 2023, even if on a hybrid basis, as long as they were doing the majority of their work from home, you want to get a head start right now for tax season on adding up all those expenses to figure out what your potential deduction would be on your 2023 tax return.
I know you mentioned that's the biggest one. Anything else come to mind?
Well, I think the normal stuff. I mean, you want to make sure that you file on time. And one thing I'll just remind people of is that, you know, if you owe money, you really want to make sure that any balance due is paid by April 30th. The reason for that, more now than ever before in the last two decades, is that the Canada Revenue Agency's prescribed interest rate has now gone to 10%. And that's for overdue or late taxes. And you have to remember that that interest is not tax deductible. For someone in a top tax bracket of 50% or more, you'd have to earn a rate of return of over 20% on an equivalent investment to be better off than not paying your tax debt. So very, very important that if you do owe money, and not very many people do, but if you do owe money on your 2023 tax return, make sure that you make that payment by April 30th so you don't get hit with that 10% non-deductible compounded daily arrears interest from the CRA.